Good evening, gents and ladymen, and welcome to another Oil of Dog. And once again, I am enthralled and thrilled to have here in the Oil of Dog studios Kevin Walmutt, who is a scientific, engineering, meticulous collector of independent music from around the world. Music created by the musicians themselves, music recorded by the musicians themselves, and he is a huge fan and follower of independent music. So, welcome, Kevin.
Thank you, Gary. I'm really honored to be here. This is sort of the whole dream and motivation of me collecting all this music, is to be able to share it with people after it's sort of long gone.
Well, I'm certainly honored to be involved in that project. And so tell me, what do you have planned for today?
Well, it happens that we're coming up on Halloween as we're recording this, which of course is developed from the Mexican Day of the Dead festival, or the ancient Catholic Day of the Dead, where we honor all souls and the people who have gone before us. So I thought we'd play a show of groups that have broken up. It was sort of a joke the first time you interviewed me that I classified some groups as dead because they had broken up, and that they weren't literally dead, but they had broken up or gone on hiatus or something, so that we didn't expect to hear from them. So I thought, let's have a show of the groups that are dead.
Groups that are dead. Okay, and this is because the veil has been separating between the other world and this world, and now we are going to visit long gone bands.
That's right, here come some ghosts.
So bands that have broken up. You know, I was talking with some people the other day about the movie Spinal Tap and how excruciating it is to watch that movie if you've ever been in a band. All the torments and travails and trials of being in a band. And so it's no wonder that you probably have a boatload of dead bands.
That is precisely what I'm talking about. You know, we talked before about how I discover music by actually going to shows in person. So I invest my time and I invest my effort into going to see these bands, following them. And, you know, and certainly not the band's fault, but just because of life and the economic system we live under, these bands don't get compensated enough to make it worth their time. They got families to feed, and you know, they make different career choices and split up, and it's just a tragedy when a really talented band can't make it commercially and they just have to split up.
All right, so how are we going to dive into this collection of dead bands for the Day of the Dead?
All right, well, let's talk about my history. Like before, in the interview before, I mentioned, and I just said again now, I started out following these local bands because some friends of mine happened to be playing, and I'd go to one of their shows, and then some other band would open for them, and I'd like that other band. So that's how I discover music. And one of the first bands that I ever started following was a high school friend of mine named Pete Wall, was the bassist for a San Francisco metal band called Pistol Apostle.
Pistol Apostle, okay.
So they were early 80s metal, so you can imagine they were kind of hair farmers wearing a lot of leather and studs and so forth.
Hair farmers, in other words, we're talking hair metal, right?
Yes.
Okay, well, I'm a secret fan of hair metal music, so.
All right, well, I hope you like this one. This one is called Bullwhip. Thank you.
Okay, so that was Pistol Apostle and a song called Bullwhip. When was that recorded?
That was about 1983, 1984. They wrote it about then, and I think they were playing it a little later.
Wow, well, that was pretty thrashy for that period of metal history. That's quite actually quite an innovative tune for the time.
A little bit punky, yeah. But it's definitely a period piece. You can hear it in the style, and you can hear it in the recording. Of course, you know, 1983, none of this was digital. It was all analog. They put it out on cassette tapes.
Very cool. All right. Well, that was great. And so what happened to Pistol Apostle?
Well, the members were pretty talented. They went on to play in some other bands. My friend Pete Wall, who was the bassist in that song, he played another band called Chum. And I think he did some contract kind of work for other musicians. But eventually he went into the construction business. So he just stopped playing music in public. And I think he still plays it for his family. He's got two nice kids now. And, you know, he has a suburban kind of life, and he isn't a metal rock star anymore.
Well, I guess that happens to a lot of us. So how long was Pistol Apostle in existence as a band?
They started when we were all in high school together. My friend Pete Wall has the same first initial of the last name as me, so we were grouped together in classrooms a lot, and that's how we became friends.
So you were talking about music in the back of the classroom every day, huh?
That's right. Pete Wall, Kevin Wolmet, you know, we're always sitting next to each other because it was high school, and they would alphabetize you. And so I believe they started about sophomore year of high school. They started at least in garages and rehearsing, and they started playing public shows, I think, about our senior year, which is 1984. And after we graduated from high school, I went to college at UC Berkeley, and they would play some shows in San Francisco. And that was pretty much one of my first exposure to public gigs. They asked me to help them with some props on one of their songs. They rev up some electric chainsaws just to really ramp up the noise, so I had to run around with the cords and handing them the chainsaws in time for the song.
Oh boy, okay. Rather dangerous work, it sounds like.
If it's not dangerous, it's not fun.
That's true. Okay, so who's next?
Okay, well, let's hear from another group from California. This is a group called Fathers and Sons, but the Sons is S-U-N-S, so Fathers and Sons out of Long Beach, California. They are much more recent. Let's see, when they were in existence was when I was living in Long Beach, so that was about 2003, I think. I guess it's not that recent. They were really popular in Long Beach, especially among college kids. They were sort of underground, you know. They were unsigned. They weren't playing big spaces, but they had a really big following among local kids in Long Beach. And their music is just very upbeat. They sort of gained recognition, and they started appearing on the internet after they won this festival in Long Beach called Busker Fest, which is an interesting idea. Everybody who goes to this festival gets a wooden coin or two, a wooden nickel, and you if you like a group, then you put your wooden nickel into the bucket in front of them, and then whoever has the most nickels at the end of the festival got some kind of a studio contract time or something like that.
And so Fathers and Sons was one of the winners of that?
That's right.
Wow, okay. All right, you know, Fathers and Sons, when I hear that in the context of rock and roll, I think of the old Muddy Waters album, which was called Fathers and Sons, and which is really a classic of the time, 1969, but this is somewhat later, I suspect.
Yes, this is much more modern.
Okay. Well, let's check out Fathers and Sons.
Now in the witching hour,
So fathers and sons, and Southern California, that in fact, they have a sound that's reminiscent to a lot of bands that my daughter, who lives in Hermosa Beach, she sends me CDs from her friends who are in bands and stuff like that. And it's still kind of a sound of that part of the world. And that's very interesting.
I think it's a distinctive style. There are things I could say about that song. I picked out that song. That's my favorite out of their whole opus, although it's kind of atypical. It's sort of a Western style when most of the rest of their music is more alternative rock or kind of pop, kind of light rock. It's all very upbeat. But that one's a little bit unusual of style. For some reason, that's my favorite song of theirs.
What's it called?
It's called Shimmering On.
Shimmering On by Fathers and Sons. Okay.
And if you listen to the lyrics, it's a ghost story. It's about I should say you're gone, but I can still feel you shimmering on. So I thought that was very appropriate for a Halloween show.
That's right. Day of the Dead continues. And so, well, what happened to Fathers and Sons? How did they come to their demise?
Well, unfortunately, they are one of the few bands, one of several bands who broke up because of basically creative differences. There were work pressures involved in that. One of them did a lot of work in New York and was constantly commuting to New York from Los Angeles. And the bassist from that band, his name is Jay. He's a good friend of mine. He started a kombucha business, and that was taking up more of his time. And if you're ever in Long Beach, you should go try Fine Feathers Kombucha, because it's just absolutely marvelous kombucha. So he's being pretty successful in that field. So apart from those economic pressures, they also sort of had differences in where they wanted the music to go. So eventually they just found it wasn't fun to rehearse and write together, and they broke up.
Alas, probably all too typical a story for a dead band.
Yeah, it still chokes me up a bit, and I'm sure I'm not alone in people who lived in Long Beach, because they were so much fun at shows. It was really a tragedy when they broke up.
Oh, boy. All right. Well, gone but not forgotten, thanks to Kevin Walmutt, my guest here in the Oil of Dog Studios, who is a meticulous and scientific collector and taxonomizer and spreadsheeter of independent music. And so, Kevin, what do we have next? What's our next dead band?
All right, let's move into a different phase here. So previously I was saying that I classify a band as dead when they've broken up or gone on hiatus, and I was joking in your first interview, none of the bands I know are actually physically dead, but I realize that's not actually true. There are a couple of musicians I know who have passed away, gone from this plane of life, and so I'm going to play a couple songs, two different songs from one of them. Another guy from Long Beach named Lewis Conway. He was involved in a lot of different bands. It's a very close-knit musical scene in Long Beach. It's really a fun place to live if you like local music, because all the bands cross-pollinate with each other. They sort of they inspire each other. People hop from one band to another. So this guy, Lewis Conway, had a little studio in his home called Till Death Studios, and he produced a lot of songs for different bands. So eventually when
this
we start
is getting way more ironic as you speak, so.
Yes, isn't it though
Okay, Till Death Studios. Okay, so I'm sorry, continue.
Sure. So Lewis produced a lot of different songs for different bands. So at some point in a future interview, when we start talking about music I have from Southern California, there's going to be three or four songs that sort of have his fingerprints on them, even though he didn't actually play.
And we are going to be literally summoning him from the grave.
That is correct, yes. It was another tragedy. When he died, he was hit by a car as a pedestrian and passed away. And so many people in the music scene just mourned his death.
Oh, my goodness. And so he produced a lot of people, and he did his own music. And so I presume we're going to hear some of his own music?
That's correct. He did some solo stuff. He was in one Long Beach band that was named Carl, and he was in another band called Toxic Shock Syndrome that we'll play. First, I'll play one of his solo pieces, which is sort of a classical jazz piece that's called In a Sentimental Groove.
Okay, Lewis Conway. Conway.
That's right.
was that recorded? This was Lewis Conway. It was an instrumental called In a Sentimental Groove.
That's right. So that was recorded by Lewis, I believe, when he was still living in Long Beach. He eventually moved to Los Angeles proper, but I think that was right around 2015, maybe 2014.
Oh, okay. So he, the electronic drums, all of that, it has sort of a chill sound, sort of a groove sound that you'd hear like in the cooling down lounges of a club or something like that.
It does, and he was a chill sort of person, but he was master of a lot of instruments. I could be mistaken, but I believe he played all those instruments and just mixed them together. And he played a lot of different genres of music. So I'm going to play another song from his, which is utterly the opposite of the spectrum. So brace yourself.
Okay, Lewis Conway, and we'll just dive in. Same guy, different sound. Well, it had great musical sophistication, so I could see how the same guy could do both tunes. Very interesting.
Very, it had sort of the same mark on it, but very different styles. And as we've discussed before, that's one of the things I love about local music. You can get such a great breadth and variety, even when it's the same darn person, you know, making the music. So the first piano tune was him playing solo, Lewis Conway, we're talking about, from Long Beach, California. And in this second tune, that was a group called Toxic Shock Syndrome, where Lewis played the bass, but I do know that he was heavily involved in writing the music. So he wasn't just a bassist. It was another friend of mine named Michael who was doing the Cookie Monster singing there. But Lewis was an integral part of writing those songs for Toxic Shock Syndrome.
Okay, so he, in other words, he did not do the keyboards on that song.
On the second one we played, I don't believe he might have. I don't actually know if he recorded the keyboards there, but typically in Toxic Shock Syndrome, he was playing the bass, certainly when they were live.
Oh, okay. Interesting. And that was called Murder Us Intent.
That's right.
Murder Us Intent. T-E-N-T. Very good. Okay,
wow. A lot of their songs have plays on words like that. So happily, I can report that that group is not actually dead. They've said that they're going to try out new bassists and put out some more music. They've had a couple of members go in and out of the group before, not because of death, but just because of differences. And so they said they're going to go on. That group is not actually dead. Only the bassist is dead.
And Kevin Walmott is the person to whom I am speaking here on Oil of Dog, and he is a collector of independent music. So when did we lose Lewis Conway?
Fairly recently. That was after I moved here to Santa Fe in early 2018. I believe it was right around January 2018.
Wow. Okay. So, wow. Very interesting. Well, Kevin, this Day of the Dead show is incredibly fascinating, and but we're at about the half hour point. So why don't we take a quick break and we'll be right back.
That's great. Give us a time to breathe.
Sounds good. I'm Gary Storm. I'll be back. Oil of Dog.
PhD JD Gary Storm returns with more after these.
Oil of Dog.
So we're here in the Oil of Dog studios, and I have here Kevin Walmott, who is an assiduous scientific spreadsheeter and student of independent music. And so Kevin is today on Oil of Dog presenting a Day of the Dead show. We're talking about bands who, for various reasons, are no longer in existence. So what's next?
Well, I'll just mention, once again, I'm very grateful to you for this opportunity to honor these people that have contributed even after their time of death. So I'll hit another physically dead artist who hits a little closer to home. This is another dead bassist from Albuquerque. This is a guy named Alec Wilkes. I hope I'm pronouncing his last name correctly, because I only met him once. But he played bass for a band called the Timewreckers, who we also played a song from when you interviewed me about Albuquerque bands, although I don't think that interview has actually aired yet. At the time, we were talking about dead bands, and I said, I don't have any bands that are actually physically dead. And then thinking about that later, I realized I was wrong about that, which sort of inspired this whole episode.
So we're going to listen to Alec Wilkes, another person who we are actually summoning from the grave, from the Timewreckers is the name of his band, right?
That's right. The Timewreckers from right here in Albuquerque.
And what's the name of the tune?
The song is called Bad Heart.
I've got it, man. I've got it.
So very interesting. Just as the song by Fathers and Sons had a very Southern California sound, that really did have a very Albuquerque, New Mexico sound.
Well, of course, that's the only thing that makes sense because they're an Albuquerque band.
Well, that does make sense. And so Alec Wilkes, he is a person. What happened to Alex? When did we lose Alex?
Unfortunately, we lost him just not even a year ago. It was, I believe he actually died in late 2017. So I was here in, I had moved here to Santa Fe by that time. I went down to the launch pad in Albuquerque to see the surf rock group Daikaiju, who we played in our Albuquerque show. Yep. And I was there with another friend of mine from Albuquerque named Mike Romero. I'll just throw a shout out to him. He's another guy like me who knows a whole lot of local bands because he just shows up to shows. So he happens to be friends with Daikaiju and also friends with the Timewreckers. So the Timewreckers came over to Mike's place after the show. He was cooking up a big pot of chili, and we hung out and drank for a few hours, and I got to know Alex Wilkes just a little tiny bit for a couple hours. I liked him. I thought we might be friends. And then a couple months went by. I was busy with work. Next time I saw the Timewreckers was about middle to early 2019. I think that was April, something like that. And Alex wasn't playing bass. And I went up and asked the singer, "Hey, what happened to Alex?" And he said, "Oh, I'm sorry. He was killed in a motorcycle accident at the beginning of the year."
Oh, my goodness. How awful.
Terrible. Yeah. So if you look closely on their Bandcamp page, and I think in the liner notes, if you buy the actual hard copy of their album, it says, you know, Alex Wilkes Forever.
Indeed. And what did Alec, what did he play?
He was the bassist.
The bass player. Okay, wow.
I don't know if he had any other talents because I only saw him at that one show before he passed away.
Being a bass player is kind of bad luck in this in this business, it sounds like.
Perhaps so, yeah.
Not like the drummers that explode in Spinal Tap.
Spinal Tap, of course.
Wow, okay. Wow, well, that's quite something. So the Timewreckers, Bad Heart. And once again, my guest is Kevin Walmutt. We're doing a Day of the Dead show here on Oil of Dog. We're celebrating bands that, for whatever reason, no longer exist, or musicians who no longer exist. So who's next?
Well, who have we got? Oh, okay. After this, a band that I followed for a very long time in San Diego called the Friday Band. They were fairly popular. They started out as just a total garage band. They spent all their time covering the samples and doing a lot of cover songs, some covers from Sublime. And eventually they started writing their own music. They are talented musicians. And after less than a year of playing, they were doing completely original sets, and they started to get bigger and bigger venues. They would play larger bars. I think they eventually played at Kane's, which was an old bar in San Diego in an amusement park, which has a pretty large space.
And so they're called the Friday Band?
Yes, they're called the Friday Band, but Friday with a Y, F-R-Y-D-A-Y.
All right.
And they also would tour in this area a little. I don't think they ever played in Santa Fe, but they played in Colorado a lot. They liked the festivals in Colorado.
Okay, and so we're going to hear, what's the name of this song?
The song is called Skylines and Smiles.
To Birmingham off of Interstate 65 with a change of clothes, you hopped on down the line. On the round the whole way down, you sang out to the skies. Smile out now, I got freedom by my side. You told me you missed the things you had, like a bedroom with a view. Your mama's cooking too.
you'll sing out to the gods. It's my life now, I got freedom by my side. She's took all the dreams of old that flow within your soul. The yours to reap and the yours to keep, and they're just as good as gold. We'll be right back.
waltz around her with my drink. It's another morning spent over the sink. Another cup of coffee, skipping up free. It's a nice man now than I'll ever be. Skyline smiles paint this town. Yeah.
So we're going to take a 5-minute break. We'll be right back. We're catching some water, so stick around. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. We got CDs and T-shirts and sign-up lists on the website stuff. Stick around.
Okay, well, that was a wonderful song, and I detected a fiddle in that song.
That's quite correct. They had a really talented fiddle, violin man named Bahman Saram. Sorry, I haven't said that name in a while, who is still playing music. He came from sort of a world music background. He likes to identify himself as Persian, so his family is basically Iranian, and so he came from sort of the traditional Middle Eastern school of music. They got him to play play kind of the college rock that the Friday Band was famous for. And Bauman is, he took a hiatus recently because he had a kid, but he is still playing violin for various world music type groups and some of his own music back in San Diego.
And so what happened to the Friday Band? Why are they on the Day of the Dead show?
Well, they're not performing together anymore. They basically broke up. They had some slight creative differences in the way they wanted to take their music, but mainly, once again, it was economics. The lead singer, Jamie, got a really good, lucrative real estate job in San Francisco, and the rest of the band was in San Diego. And who else? Troy, the drummer, another really talented musician, he eventually got a job with Homeland Security working nights, which sort of interferes with your ability to play music in pubs at nights.
Yeah, so, golly day. I mean, if you're going to be a musician, you can't have a night job, a day-night job.
Exactly. So it was just, once again, pulled apart by life. They got careers. Some of them got kids and so on. But I do have to mention that the keyboardist, Jeremy Miller, is still plays keyboards sometimes, you know, as backing for other musicians. He runs various open mic nights and produces music in San Diego. So he's still very plugged into the music scene. You know, whenever I go back to visit San Diego, one of the first things I do is call Jamie up or email him or something and say, all right, who's playing this week? Because he just knows all the bands in the San Diego area, and he's very plugged in still.
Okay, Jeremy, what's his name?
His last name is Miller. So if you're in San Diego and you want some music produced, look up Miller Time Music on the internet and go visit Jeremy's studio.
Okay, well, there you go. So that was going to be my advice, too. So I'm sorry. Fire away.
As long as we're talking about Day of the Dead, well, an idea that I worked on with Jeremy that I'll just give this away on the airways for anyone who wants to take it up. At one point, I considered starting a Kickstarter called the Day of the Dead, where the idea was to have a weekend music festival where on Saturday you invite bands that have broken up to reunite and play a small set, and then whoever whichever band wins the audience appreciation, however you measure that, would win a recording contract as part of this Kickstarter. And then on Sunday you would have an All Souls Day where you invite bands that are still together. Yeah, we tried getting that going, but Jeremy pointed out, you know, it's so difficult to get everybody to come to a rehearsal when your band is still together. So reuniting dead bands is just a really daunting task.
Yeah, I would say that the practicalities of that, I mean, any type of relationship, once it's gone, if you want them to get together and play nice, then that ain't going to always happen. So.
Isn't it such a fantasy, though, when these groups break up? We just wish they would come back together, don't we?
All we are asking is give peace a chance. Well, Kevin Walmut, we're coming up on another half hour here on Oil of Dogs, so I hope you don't mind if we take another break.
That's fine. We all need a little rest, as in rest in peace.
Rest in peace. I'm Gary Storm. I'll be back.
Oil of Dog.
Stay tuned for more Oil of Dog with Gary Storm after these.
Gary returns with more Oil of Dog. Next.
Okay, welcome back. We're here in the Oil of Dog studios, and my guest is Kevin Walmut.
Boo, who did I scare you?
Did you say, oh, boo. Yep, I got scared. So we're doing a Day of the Dead show. Kevin is a careful and meticulous collector and analyzer and a taxonomizer of independently released music. And so, Kevin, what's next here on the Day of the Dead show? We're celebrating bands who no longer exist.
Well, once again, I'm so glad that you're allowing me this opportunity to expose people to music that is dead and gone and would otherwise probably rarely be heard again. So the next band is another band that's broken up from San Diego. The band was called Three Against One, and the song is called Monster. So the last song, the Friday Band, was sort of a college rock vibe, and these guys are sort of heavy rock, heavy metal, kind of a little bit punkish.
And they're called
Three Against One.
Three Against One. Okay.
Shut the door, it's getting cold in here. She's on her knees reliving.
moving much too slow, with no place for me to go. Shut the door, it's getting cold in here. He's on his knees, believing his fear. Your traffic moving much too slow, with no place for me to go. Shut the door's getting cold in here. She's on her knees holding back all her tears. Your traffic moving much too slow, with no place for me to go. The door's getting cold in here. She's on her knees reliving her years. Traffic moving much too slow, with no place for me to go.
Well, that was great. I would call that contemporary punk. It was well performed. It was everything was great on it. That was terrific.
Glad you liked it. I sort of grouped them and the last band together in my mind, even though they're very different styles. I discovered them both at the same place in Pacific Beach, which is a district of San Diego. There's a bar that used to be called Blind Melons back when I was discovering these bands. When I was living there around 2000, 2001, 2003, that kind of era, it's called something different now, and I'm not sure what relationship that bar had with the group Blind Melon, but
it certainly raises that question with a name like that. Yes,
I think there was some connection, and then the bar got new management or was sold or something, and it's now called the 710 Club, and it's still a good place to discover new local music. They like to give a shot to groups that don't otherwise get exposure. So there are various times in my life when I was living there in Pacific Beach and I was depressed or down for one reason or another, and I just walked over to Blind Melon and said, all right, who's playing tonight? And those were two of my discoveries there. I just walked in, never seen them before, enjoyed their music, and followed them around to other gigs for years and years.
Well, very cool.
Well, I had the thought, I've been dominating this conversation for an hour or so, but I know that you had a musical history before you became a DJ, so I was wondering, what sort of bands have you played in that are not playing anymore for whatever reason?
Well, my first band actually was called Extra Cheese.
That's a great name.
Well, it wasn't that great a name. It was simply came about when the band members were sitting around eating pizza trying to figure out what the heck we should call the band. So there it is, Extra Cheese.
They say write what you know.
And so And actually, I formed the band with a friend of mine who's still a good friend of mine. His name is Bruno Clark, and he was one of the founding members of Sha Na Na.
Wow.
And he's the only guy I know, or only person I've ever known, who actually played at Woodstock.
But he's still among the living, right?
He's still among the living, but unfortunately, Extra Cheese demised many, many decades ago. The song that I showed you is a song that we recorded it in the middle 1970s. So this is ancient history, or late 70s maybe. And it's a song that Bruno and I wrote together. I came up with the lyrics and he devised the appropriate music.
That sounds great to me. I say let's honor the past. That's my whole thought for this show. Let's give a shout out to the bands that are no longer playing.
Well, this is for Extra Cheese then, and this is a song called Revolt of the Foods.
We are the meat. You are what we are. We are what you eat. But when you gobble, we feel the pain. Such horrible pain. But we won't take it. We won't take it. We won't take it no more. Right, salt, sour, and sweet. You make us so appealing.
Only to devour us, the better to devour us. But we won't take it. We won't take it. We won't take it no more.
Thank you, Kevin, for letting me reminisce about that tune.
Dare I even profane the name and offer you the honor of saying that that song was Zappa-esque?
Oh, heck no. I am more than honored. Zappa has always been one of my heroes.
Great. Well...
So, do you have yet more dead bands to share with us tonight?
Well, I have a lot of dead bands on my list, but there's only one more that I had planned for the actual session tonight. There's a band, this band is was called Logic, L-O-J-I-C, which was a hip-hop group out of St. Louis, Missouri, and I met them in Los Angeles. They moved to Los Angeles. They really were a very successful regional band in St. Louis, or near St. Louis, around St. Louis, and they decided they're going to take their fame and move to L.A. and give it a shot. And man, having grown up in LA, I just feel so sorry for bands that do that, because LA is a cruel city. You know, these are supremely talented musicians with a history of success, and you go to LA and you're just another face in the crowd. It's very depressing.
Wow, so they went to LA to make it big and didn't.
They didn't quite make it big. They played a lot of good shows, and like I say, they're a talented band. I think that was the first show that I saw them. They actually opened for Mike Watt at a place called Central Social in LA, so that was a fantastic show. I went there for Mike Watt, of course. I'd never heard of this band from Missouri before, and they're sort of hip-hop.
Okay, cool. And actually, one of the, they're no relation, I presume, to the great rapper who is around today named Logic.
That's right. There's no relation but the name, as far as I know. Maybe he took inspiration from them, I know.
But he spells it as L-O-G-I-C. So.
Right. The right way.
Yes. Okay, so this, and so I guess the pressures of trying to survive in LA just drove this band to pieces. Is that a valid presumption?
That's more like it. Most of them stayed in music. They sort of split up, although the lead singer, he moved back to St. Louis, and he got a regular job, but he does occasionally sing for a Fishbone cover group. Oh, what's the name of that cover group now? I can't think of his cover group right this instant. But I saw a couple of their shows, and they were fantastic. They were a lot of fun. The guitarist still plays occasional solo shows on the Sunset Strip, and the drummer has his own studio and is giving drum lessons.
Let's check out Logic. And what's the name of the tune?
Song is called Beginnings Never End, so appropriate for the last song I have to play.
Absolutely.
I see the future when I sleep. Dreams of things you won't believe. Empty children eating lies. A call to heal brings me to chasing golden puppet strings, suede of lies and shiny things, while imaginary kings kill a world we never see. Staring at the sun, what have we become? Years and summer say. We can make our escape. Our beginnings never end. Where we wander, all demands.
Recognize the seeing eye, almighty architect, relaying messages in several different dialects. Even though it's not at all what I am looking for, the possibilities are something I can gotta grow. The problems are so many problems. People up above look down at people suffering. We've all been fooled. No matter what they say, it's up to you.
Staring at the sun, what have we become? Years and summer shade. No one sees us. Our beginnings never.
Well, I'd call that an example of present-day ska.
I'm not sure I would contradict you there. That's not a bad way to put them. Because like I say, the lead singer, they had two lead singers. I really should explain this. Will was lead singer for the kind of hip-hop part that was right in the middle of there. They had another lead singer, Johnny O'Neill, who sang the beginning of it. And so, like I say, Will was heavily influenced by Fishbone. I finally remembered the name of his cover band. It's Ghetto Soundwave, which I believe is the name of either Fishbone song or Fishbone album. I'm not totally, you know, conversant on Fishbone's whole opus, but Will still sings Fishbone covers in St. Louis, and you can just tell from that song, you know, audiences would get into them. They're played very moving music, and they still make great music as solo artists, but they're all split up now.
And actually that song was quite a mashup. It had, you know, a little bit of the rap in it. It had definitely a ska beat through much of it, but then it sort of went into a slow kind of dreamy fade out there.
That's exactly how I describe it. That's quite right. A lot of moving parts there, and the song really means something to me for Day of the Dead when we're honoring these bygone bands. It starts out with sort of an apocalyptic dystopian description of life, and then it segues into this sort of more relaxing, dreamy thing. And I find sort of a similar experience in my own musical career, because, you know, from your other interviews you've done with me, I've lived in a lot of different places, different cities that have different music scenes, and it's sometimes happened, you know, I'll live in Long Beach and then I move away for 5 years and then I move back to Long Beach and all the groups that I know have broken up or they're gone, they're not playing, and it seems like, you know, initially it seems like some sort of apocalyptic wasteland where I'm the only survivor of this dead and gone music scene. But eventually, you know, like the song says, beginnings never end. Eventually, if I hang around Long Beach long enough, there are these little green shoots that come poking up through the rubble. You know, somebody's formed another band, somebody's a producer of music and now has turned me on to some younger bands, and then so if I hang around long enough and stay optimistic, I can find a whole nother cycle of music after the first one has burned to the ground.
Right, the music will never die.
That's right.
Well, and that's actually part of your responsibility here is to make sure that it doesn't.
I try my best.
Well, cool. Well, Kevin, once again, a fascinating and thought-provoking selection of independent music. And so I'm talking to Kevin Walmott. He is a collector of independent music. And tonight we've been listening to bands that, for one reason or another, and for all the reasons that bands can cease to exist, none of these exist anymore. And we're doing it in celebration of the Day of the Dead.
And once again, I'm really grateful for the opportunity. The whole reason that I hang on to these songs is because there's this quality in them, and nobody else is going to hear them if I don't preserve them.
And that's one of the purposes of Oil of Dog as well, is to share and awaken the world to all the great independent music that's being made in bedrooms and garages and little studios and being released by musicians on their own on Bandcamp and SoundCloud and every other place where music gets out into the world.
Well, I'm very glad you had me on, and I encourage everyone listening to find your own local music, and there's bound to be something you like in your own town. You don't have to look too far.
That's right. Go have a brew and go listen to some tunes. Well, Kevin, thank you so much, and we'll be having you back soon. I certainly hope we'll be having you back soon.
Once again, it's my pleasure. I'd be happy to come back and play some more dead and gone bands, obscure bands from my history.
Excellent. Well, thank you, Kevin Walmott, and I'm Gary Storm. I'll be back.
Oil of Dog.
Oil of Dog with Gary Storm returns in a moment.